Imagine you're in a genetics lab and you want to perform a genetic test. Whether it's a simple polymerase chain reaction, microarray, or even high-throughput sequencing. Regardless of the specific tools and reagents used in each method, all of them will require a genetic sample of the subject. The genetic information obtained depends significantly on the type of disease or test you are conducting, but it falls into two main categories: genomic DNA and total RNA from the subject's cells. The choice and utilization of each category rely on the specific information taken from subject's genetic material. Genomic DNA is primarily employed to identify alterations in the genetic sequence of individuals. These alterations may vary in size and shape, from small variations such as single nucleotide polymorphisms to large modifications that can include deletion or duplication of segments of the genome can all be identified through the examination of genomic DNA samples. But how can we obtain genomic DNA and from which tissues? Essentially, all cellular life forms containing a nucleus can be utilized for DNA extraction. Therefore, you can technically extract the required DNA from every tissue in human body, excluding red blood cells, due to the obvious absence of the nucleus. The most commonly used samples for DNA extraction include blood, cheek swab, also known as buccal samples, and saliva. Although the latter two options are easier to obtain, blood samples remain the preferred choice for DNA extraction in genetic laboratories. A few reasons for this preference are as follows. Blood contains a relatively high concentration of nucleated cells, them being leukocytes or white blood cells, which are rich in DNA. This makes blood a good source for obtaining substantial amounts of high-quality DNA. Blood samples are most often not contaminated with other life forms. Many DNA extraction protocols and kits are optimized for blood samples. Genetic labs have established protocols and workflows for blood-derived DNA, making it convenient for researchers to follow standardized procedures. Several techniques have been devised for DNA extraction. In this video, we will specifically discuss the salt-and-out method. But before we get to that, please take a moment to support us by subscribing to this channel. And don't forget to hit the like button and activate the bell so you won't miss future uploads. The salt-and-out method is relatively simple and utilizes basic laboratory equipment and reagents. It doesn't necessitate a specialized material or intricate procedures, making it accessible for researchers and labs with limited resources. In terms of cost-effectiveness, it stands out compared to other techniques, as it doesn't involve expensive reagents or specialized kits. Importantly, the salt-and-out method typically yields a high amount of DNA, rendering it suitable for applications that demand a substantial quantity of genetic material, such as PCR or polymerase chain reaction or DNA sequencing. The salt-and-out method starts out by the cell lysis step. In this phase, a carefully crafted lysis buffer plays a pivotal role in dismantling cellular structures. The buffer maintains a stable pH, essential for preserving enzymatic activity. It also contains EDTA, which serves as a chelating agent inhibiting nucleases that could degrade DNA. Enzymes, including proteases, work synergistically with detergents like SDS to break down proteins and disrupt cell membrane. This orchestrated disruption ensures the efficient release of cellular contents, including DNA. The buffer, along with the sample, are added into a microtube and the mix is incubated so the components of the buffer can perform their functions. In the next step, a high concentration of salt, often sodium chloride, is introduced to transform the lysate into a hypertonic solution. This strategic manipulation of salt concentration influences the solubility of macromolecules within the solution. Proteins, being integral cellular components, experience reduced solubility in this hypertonic environment, leading to their precipitation. This step is critical for separating proteins from the DNA of interest, setting the stage for subsequent purification. Centrifugation separates components based on density. After protein precipitation, the lysate undergoes centrifugation, subjecting the sample to high gravitational forces. This process results in the formation of distinct protein pellets at the bottom of the tube. Simultaneously, the lighter DNA and other cellular components remain in the supernatant. The separation achieved here is crucial for isolating DNA from contaminants and proteins. Following centrifugation, the supernatant enriched with DNA is transferred into a new tube to undergo precipitation. This step involves the addition of alcohol, typically isopropanol or ethanol. This gradual increase in alcohol concentration induces a change in the solubility of DNA. As DNA molecules lose their solubility, they aggregate and precipitate out of the solution, forming a visible mass. The tube undergoes another round of centrifugation, further precipitating the DNA into a pellet. This step further separates the DNA from residual alcohol and other impurities present in the supernatant. To enhance DNA purity, a washing step is introduced. The DNA pellet is carefully washed with a suitable solution, commonly ethanol. This wash step aims to remove residual salts, protein, and other contaminants that might still be associated with the DNA. Rigorous washing ensures the production of high-quality purified DNA. The final phase involves resuspending the purified DNA pellet into an appropriate buffer for distilled water. This step is critical for ensuring that the DNA is in an optimal state for downstream applications. By the end of this step, you will ideally have your required amount of genomic DNA for your downstream genetic analysis. If you found this DNA extraction procedure fascinating, stay tuned for more in-depth exploration into the world of genetics. Our channel is dedicated to bringing you insightful content on genetics, bioinformatics, and scientific discoveries. Thank you for being part of our scientific community. If you have any specific topics you'd like us to cover in the future videos, please drop your suggestions in the comments below. Until next time, keep exploring the wonders of science and take care.